To all esteemed speakers, chairperson.
Recording in progress.
And all respected doctors on behalf of Cimenta Division of Sun Pharma. I welcome you all for today's wonderful webinar. As we all know that tomorrow is going to have Mental Health Day. So on the eve of this, we are going to have a seminar on neuropsychiatric aspect of frontotemporal dementia. And we are very lucky and honored as we have two very eminent speakers in India and our very senior Professor Molloy Ghoshal, chairperson, who is ex-HOD from Medical College. And this seminar will be moderated by Dr. Praveen Kumar, who is HOD and consultant psychiatrist of Institute of Neuroscience, Kolkata. So what to say, Dr. Praveen Kumar, sir?
Soumik, next slide, please. Yeah. Okay. So, Abir, can we ask to mute some of the sounds?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Fine. So, good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome you all for first of its kind neuropsychiatry grand round webinar series. So, like 21st century commentators call for an integration of neurology, psychiatry, and neuroscience. And a neuropsychiatry subspecialty is growing like anything in Western countries. And we will see in near future that it will be a subspecialty in India too. So basically, a neuropsychiatry deals with like psychological and behavioral manifestations of brain disease and structural brain disease. So basically, it focuses on relationship between brain and behavior. So if you see that, like a lot of disorders have this both overlap neurology and psychiatry, especially neurocognitive disorders. When it comes to neurocognitive disorders, disorders like movement disorder, like Tourette syndrome, psychiatric disorders associated with Parkinson's disease, psychiatric disorders associated with epilepsy, psychiatric disorders associated with cerebral vascular disease, head injury. So, and also like a lot of neuroimmunological disorder where like anti-NMD encephalitis, these are the disorders where there is a crosstalk between neurologist and psychiatrist. And so there is a neuropsychiatric approach is required to diagnose and manage these disorders. So in an attempt to raise awareness about neuropsychiatric subspecialty, so I and Dr. Krishnamurthy sir thought that like we should start some small webinar series, especially on different neuropsychiatric topics. So in that view, so this is our first webinar topic. So that's on frontotemporal dementia, and for this topic, we have such a fantastic eminent speakers, so who are almost like an experts in India. So on this topic, so to chair this session, and we have a fantastic academician, Dr. Molloy Ghoshal sir is like ex professor and head of the department of psychiatry from Medical College Kolkata. So he had 25 years of experience in teaching PG students. His special areas of interest are dementia. So whenever you talk about dementia, sir agrees. Like in a spontaneously to attend such webinars. So that is his interest area. Sir also has interest in organic psychiatry, and he was also associated with memory clinic, which was run jointly by neuromedicine and department of psychiatry in Medical College Kolkata. He has almost 45 publications in different and national and international journals. Samik, next slide. And we have an eminent speaker who is an almost like an expert in FTD in India. So Dr. Ratnamali, madam, is a consultant neurologist and specialist in cognitive neurology at Manipal Hospital and Annaswamy Mudaliar Hospital at Bangalore. So she's also adjunct professor at Manipal Academy of Health Education, and she has obtained fellowship in cognitive neurology under Professor John Artis, so one of the leading experts in FTD. So she started the first memory clinic in India and currently heads cognitive disorder clinic in several centers in India. She has extensive experience of more than 2 decades in diagnosing and managing patients with FTD. She has published several important papers on different aspects of FTD. And her first author paper on the prevalence of FTD in neurology has more than significant citations. And she is the member of International Neuropsychiatry FTD Consortium, she's also a committee member of Cognitive Professional Interest Area Association, and also co-chairs the low and middle income countries diversity group PI of Alzheimer's Association. And we are extremely honored to get our speaker, Dr. Ratnavali Madam, for our webinar. And as her CV tells that, she's an almost guide on FTD in India. And Samik, next slide. Our next speaker is Dr. Ennapadam Krishnamurthy. Sir is a behavioral neurologist and neuropsychiatrist. He's a founder of Buddhi Clinic and NeuroKrish. He's a pioneer of integrated and holistic care and rehabilitation of brain and mind. Sir was an ex-president of International Neuropsychiatric Association. He has taken multiple international leadership roles in the treatment of epilepsy, dementia, and neuropsychiatric disorders. And he's the editor of Global series for Cambridge Press and Neuropsychiatry Across Cultures for Oxford University. He has, to his credit, 70 plus scientific papers, 30 plus book articles, and 25 articles in the lay press, has lectured widely across the forums. So he also convenes the T.S. Srinivasan Conclave and Oration annually. So he's adjunct professor at Manipal University and Public Health Foundation, and also a senior clinical advisor, Neurosciences Apollo Hospital Group. And sir conducts extensive academic programs on neuropsychiatry, especially on dementia. Every year, sir organizes an international program with a variety of international speakers, and he has played a significant role in developing neuropsychiatry as a subspecialty in India. So we'll be honored to hear from two distinguished speakers. So over to Dr. Malay Bhushan, sir, to start the session on FTD. Thank you.
Thank you, Praveen. Good evening, everybody. I am honored and privileged to chair a session of two most erudite and academic researchers of this subject. At the same time, I am very delighted that the topics are very close to my heart. There are two topics. One topic is prefrontal cortex and behavior, and then the next topic is the overview of frontotemporal dementia, diagnostic and therapeutic issues. Now, coming to the first topic, it is a burning topic of research. What makes us unique? Mark Hosher, who has worked in this extensively, has given a term for this humanicness. Still, what qualities makes us separate from great apes is not universally accepted. Some of the qualities which have been accepted are complex emotions, metacognitions, some language functions, social cognition, foresight, art, music, etc. And most of them are prefrontal functions. And that's why prefrontal cortex occupies almost 29% of the volume of the brain in humans. One of the critical functions of prefrontal cortex is executive function, and the concept is ever-changing. We are eager to listen from Professor Krishnamurthy on this different aspect controlled by prefrontal cortex. Regarding the second topic, frontotemporal dementia was rather neglected in the early ages of dementia research until the Lund and Manchester groups restored the interest again in the late 20th century. A Neary group gave the consensus clinical diagnostic criteria. Then other researchers like John Hodges has given the concept of semantic dementia, and Professor Mesulam elaborated the concept of primary progressive aphasia, but the problem lies with the diagnosis of behavioral variety of frontotemporal disorder. The Neary criteria was criticized, and Raskowski's group gave separate criteria for behavioral variety of frontotemporal dementia. But still, the sensitivity and specificity are being questioned. Even with the help of structural MRI, and FDG PET, the sensitivity and specificity remains around 70%. And 50% of the behavioral variety of frontotemporal dementia patients initially present with psychiatric problems, and the latent period for reaching a diagnosis of FTD is 5 to 8 years in different studies. Moreover, the C9orf72 genetic mutation is notorious for presenting with psychiatric symptoms. The most common symptoms are of mania, depression, and OCD. We, in our limited experience, have mistakenly diagnosed primary psychiatric disorder in FTD in our memory clinic and vice versa. So to solve the problem, Neuropsychiatric International Consortium for Frontotemporal Dementia was recently established under Simon Doctrine of Montreal, and they are trying to differentiate primary psychiatric disorder from FTD by history taking, psychiatric assessment, clinical scale, physical and neurological examination, bedside cognitive test, neuropsychological assessment, social cognition, structural neuroimaging, functional neuroimaging, CSF, and genetic testing. Behavioral variety of frontotemporal dementia is a disease where psychiatrist and neurologist should work conjointly to resolve the diagnostic dilemma. We are fortunate to listen this from one of the members of this group and who is a frontline researcher in the frontotemporal dementia, Professor Ratnavali. So with this, I am handing over the mic to Dr. Praveen for further proceeding.
So now we have a first talk from Dr. Krishnamurthy sir on prefrontal cortex and behavior. Over to you, sir.
I'm just going to share my screen.
Sure.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Honorable Chairman, Dr. Praveen, my colleague, Dr. Ratnavali, and Sun Pharmaceuticals. Thank you for organizing this, and it's a great pleasure to be here at this Neuropsychiatry Symposium. I'm talking as a clinician practicing neuropsychiatry, and I'm not an expert in FTD, but I would like to share some observations about the prefrontal lobe and the mood and behavior and how does it differentiate from psychiatric disorders, what Professor Ghoshal was highlighting. I'll start by quoting my teacher, Professor Trimble. In his book, The Intentional Brain, he begins by making it clear that neuropsychiatry is not just the bridge between neurology and psychiatry. It's not just the narrow space in the Venn diagram between the specialities, but it is an independent discipline that occupies the hinterland between the neurosciences and psychiatry. And I hope I can convince you as we go forward that this is indeed true and that neuropsychiatry has got some very distinct elements to it. When we try to differentiate neuropsychiatric phenomena from psychiatric conditions, we look at certain features. First, antecedents. Most neuropsychiatric conditions have neurological antecedents: brain injury, tumor, vascular malformations, infections, inflammations, degeneration. Many things cause neuropsychiatric symptoms. Sometimes, of course, we don't recognize that there is one of these antecedents taking place. In psychiatry, on the other hand, we do look for psychogenic precipitants, life events and circumstances that precipitate symptoms. We don't always find them, but we do often come to a conclusion as well. We then look at unique characteristics. Neuropsychiatric phenomena are rather unique. They defy conventional descriptions. Take, for example, the complex visual hallucinations that you see in neuropsychiatry, or Lilliputian hallucinations that you see in neuropsychiatry. There's a wonderful paper in Brain several years ago that talked about the many things that can cause complex visual hallucinations. On the other hand, in conventional psychiatry, we do experience hallucinations, but they don't often take the form of Lilliputian or complex visual hallucinations. Third, we look at the course. In neuropsychiatry, it's often unpredictable. The symptoms can be brief or can be long-standing without remissions in the case of a degenerative condition. In psychiatry, symptoms appear to present, evolve, and remit over a period of time. They are somewhat more predictable, or one is able to understand why those symptoms are taking place. In neuropsychiatry, we are unable to link the symptoms often to context. There is no link to mood or thought process and the symptom. So it's almost as if the symptom is alien to the person. In psychiatry, the symptoms are often linked clearly with mood and thought process. Intent in neuropsychiatry is unclear, and emotional discontrol is often a key driver for neuropsychiatric symptoms. In psychiatry, even patients who are delusional are able to describe the intent behind their actions. A simple question, why did you do something? Often, you get a reasonable explanation in psychiatry. You will not get a reasonable explanation in neuropsychiatric disorders. There is this underlying phenomenon of MBI, or mild behavioral dysfunction. And this is characterized by very much all the things that Professor Cummings has described in his neuropsychiatric inventory, or NPI. Agitation, anxiety, irritability, apathy, aspontaneity, depression, delusions, indifference, disinhibition, emotional lability, euphoria, impulsivity, loss of empathy, insight, and personal hygiene, oral eating behavior changes. I'm sure we'll hear more about this from Dr. Ratnavalli, and sleep disorders. Very often, these are seen in neuropsychiatric conditions. For many years, the prefrontal cortex was considered the silent lobe, and it was thought that the lesions caused little by way of neurological deficit. Indeed, it became the site of lobotomies for psychiatric disorders. In the last few decades, the importance of the prefrontal cortex as a region for cognition and behavior has become very apparent, although it still remains poorly understood. Even in conditions like depression and symptoms like anhedonia, functional neuroimaging studies reveal abnormalities in the prefrontal cortex. And treatments today, biological treatments that we rely upon for conditions like depression, RTMS, for example, the prefrontal cortex has become a region of substantive interest. Now, we look at the prefrontal cortex in certain ways. So if we consider the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, patients present with a loss of initiative and diminished motivation. The affect is flattened. There's an outward display of apathy and indifference. Verbal output is reduced, and they have a behavioral slowness, which is clinically characterized as abulia. And I'll talk a little bit about abulia and apathy in a little while. It's associated with inability to plan and maintain sequences of goals and actions, what is called goal neglect. So executive function is what is disturbed. And therefore, in a dorsolateral prefrontal cortex syndrome, this is the brain viewed from the front, you have executive function defects, you have perseveration, you have stimulus-bound behavior. There's a famous video of someone offering their spectacles to the person, and the person takes it and puts it on. And then there is diminished verbal fluency. Then we move to the orbitofrontal cortex, which is the more florid syndrome that we often encounter, especially after traumatic brain injury or after a stroke. Loss of inhibitory and emotional control is a key feature. There's an inability to function effectively in the social domain. Impulsive risk-taking behavior is a hallmark, and the person demonstrates poorly modulated emotional reactions, disinhibited or socially inappropriate behavior, impaired decision-making, a failure to use emotions to guide their decision-making, an inability to recognize emotional expression, deficits in social and moral reasoning, and deficits in emotional empathy. this is something I'm sure Professor Ratnavali will also put up. It's the famous skull, brain, and tamping rod of Phineas Gage, a case well described by Dr. John Harlow. This was a railroad worker in America who was responsible and socially well adjusted before an accident. And what was the accident? There was a blasting process taking place, and the tamping rod, flew away from the blast, and it went through his skull, as shown in the diagram. Initially, the injury was thought to be bilateral, but later it was found to be more a left hemisphere injury with extensive white matter disconnection. And in future studies, Lemasio and all, I thought that there was possible involvement of the anterior temporal lobe and the amygdala as well. But what he was described as after this happened was that he was no longer Gage. There was a personality change in him. And that personality change is what we see in orbitofrontal syndrome with disinhibition and inappropriate affect, impaired judgment, and distractibility. With the medial frontal cortex, with the dorsomedial, we have emotional instability, inattention. Again, the word ebulia crops up, and we'll talk about that, and akinetic mutism. With ventromedial lesions, we see disrupted social behavior as well as social, emotional, and value-based decision-making being affected. Patients with ACC lesions lack the will to move and talk, even though they are capable of both. They have abnormal autonomic arousal, and they have loss of motivation. So the medial prefrontal cortex is rather complex, and as you can see, if I can summarize it, apathy, mutism, transcortical aphasia, lower extremity paresis, and incontinence. And if you can think of from medical school the homunculus and how it's the body is represented to the brain, you'll remember that the leg dangles down the middle, ideally on both sides. And you can understand why a problem in this region causes lower extremity paresis and incontinence. So we've heard the term apathy, we've heard the term ebulia. One is more psychiatric and the other more neurological. Apathy is a lack of motivation, diminished goal-directed behavior, and decreased emotional engagement. And it's seen in almost a third of all patients with mild cognitive impairment. It has been described in a number of conditions, including depression and prefrontal cortex syndromes, and it appears to be a more generic symptom. Ebulia, on the other hand, which was extensively written about by Bhatia and Marsden in 1994 in their paper in Brain, is reduced spontaneous verbal, motor, cognitive, and emotional behavior in the setting of a clear consciousness, and has been associated with lesions of the basal ganglia, the caudate nucleus, the globus pallidus, the thalamus, and the frontal lobes. It's described in Parkinson's disease and the Parkinson plus syndromes, progressive supranuclear palsy, and other PFC syndromes, and it's rather more specific to organic brain dysfunction. Professor Marsden, when we once asked him, how would you differentiate ebulia from apathy, described the golf test. And the golf test was his patient who retired to live in front of a golf course so that he could play golf. But as his Parkinson's progressed, even though he was not physically unable to play, he would sit and watch people golf. He wasn't disinterested, but he simply lacked the get up and go to go and play. And this remain interested yet lacking the let get up and go to go and play was what Marsden called the golf test for ebulia. And of course, the prefrontal cortex, when you look at the links with psychiatry, you have problems with mood in both. There's low mood and crying spells in depression. With apathy and ebulia, mood is not really affected. Interest, there is an inability to experience emotions or anhedonia in depression. There is loss of interest in apathy or a loss of motivation to act in ebulia. Some people think that ebulia is an extreme form of apathy, but that is not really a widely shared or agreed view. Then, of course, people who are depressed are usually distressed by the experience and may seek a change. People who are going through apathy or abulia appear to be quite unaffected by what they are experiencing. And of course, quite the opposite is described as IEED, or emotional incontinence syndromes, or pseudobulbar effect, or pathological emotionalism. And this is seen in a number of neurological syndromes, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, multiple sclerosis, traumatic brain injury, dementia, stroke, and of course, it's a feature, as I've described, of the prefrontal cortex. I'm sure Professor Ratnavali will talk about hypersexuality as a particular feature of behavioral variant frontotemporal dementia. And when compared with Alzheimer's, hypersexuality seems to be unique to FTD. But hypersexuality as a neuropsychiatric symptom is well known, because you see hypersexuality also in temporal lobe epilepsy. And you also see it in the Clover-Busey syndrome. And therefore, although temporal lobe epilepsy is better known for hyposexuality, there are patients who have both hyper and hyposexuality. A famous patient with temporal lobe epilepsy who had both was Vincent van Gogh. And then, of course, there are other factors that you can use to differentiate. The disinhibition in prefrontal cortex syndromes is often out of context. In mania and schizophrenia, there is context to the disinhibition. The mood is not overtly different, although there may be emotional lability in prefrontal cortex syndromes. The mood change is very evident, obviously, in psychiatric disorders. In the hypersexuality in prefrontal cortex syndromes is described as clumsy and displays of overtly sexual behavior. Whereas in psychiatry, the behavior can vary from appropriately flirtatious to overtly lewd and sexual. And the emotional incontinence is very unique to the prefrontal cortex. Crying without tears is well described. Whereas in psychiatry, emotional incontinence is often mood congruent, although it may be out of proportion. There are specific scales like the BEHAVE-AD and the NPI that you can use to assess behavior. And there are specific scales to assess frontal lobe syndromes, which I'm sure Dr. Ratnavali will allude to in her talk. So to sum it up, prefrontal cortex dysfunction leads to a range of mood and behavioral issues, and there's a definite role for the paralimbic association areas. Differentiating, as Professor Ghoshal pointed out right in the beginning, differentiating prefrontal cortex syndromes from core psychiatric symptoms is complex, especially because the region is now implicated in a range of primary psychiatric disorders. And our novel treatment efforts, our use of dopaminergic agents in psychiatry, our use of RTMS, are also focused on this area. Good history taking and clinical evaluation are extremely important, as also establishing the links to specific cognitive deficits. An understanding of antecedents, unique characteristics, course, context, and intent, as also practice in stroke and TBI units, is what is likely to enrich us in our ability to differentiate the frontotemporal dementia or variations of frontotemporal dementia or other neuropsychiatric syndromes from conventional psychiatric syndromes. I'd like to leave you with a thought also that it's possible to rehabilitate these patients at least for some of their symptoms. And, it's very important to remember, therefore, that preserved function and good family support can be used in order to help a patient with these behavioral syndromes. And I think I should stop there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the very nice presentation. So, as you said, prefrontal cortex sometimes is being described as a seat of emotions and behavior, and how this dysfunction leads to different mood and behavioral issues, very nicely elaborated by you, sir. So as you know, as we know that like prefrontal cortex is being implicated in many psychiatric disorders, like the core psychiatric disorder like schizophrenia, sometimes people say that it's a frontotemporal disconnection disorder. That's also being described. Even in autism research, it shows that there are dysfunctions in prefrontal cortex and temporal lobe. So, and one of the key disorder which is being like, that's the frontotemporal dementia, where there is the clear evidence that there is a degeneration in frontal and temporal cortex, that too in a progressive fashion. So that's being studied. So, with this, we'll go to now clinical talk. So will be by Dr. Ratnamali Madam. So we'll be taking sir questions at the end of the session for the question and answer session. Over to you, Madam.
Thank you so much. I'll just share my screen.
Yes.
So you can see my slides, all right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So thank you, Dr. Praveen, for this very kind invitation. And I also would like to thank Dr. Krishnamurthy for this invitation and Sun Pharmaceuticals for arranging this talk. And I think it's an excellent idea to have these grand rounds or seminars on neuropsychiatric syndromes. And it's very important that clinicians, psychiatrists and neurologists get together to understand and study these disorders together. I think that's a very good idea. And I also would like to wish you all a happy Dashara. And after that excellent talk by Dr. Krishnamurthy, which was very lucid in trying to understand how to differentiate the organic syndromes from primary psychiatric disorders, I think he's given a lot of tips. So I'll try and give you an overview of frontotemporal dementia. So we start with a clinical vignette. So this is a 76-year-old male who was a retired sociology professor, but pre-morbidly he was extroverted and slightly maybe disinhibited. He used to talk to the cab drivers, shopkeepers about his work and activism. But he presented to the clinic with motor symptoms of 1 year, where he had difficulty in walking and falls. He also had some involuntary movements and some occasional urinary symptoms. He developed cognitive problems for the last 1 year, which was memory impairment, forgetting names, became repetitive, but he also had behavioral changes where he became more tangential, stubborn. He was noticed to be a little withdrawn, lost interest, as well as there was some reporting of empathy. He had increased preference for sweets. He was hypertensive and diabetic as well, but there was family history of schizophrenia in the brother. And the dad had an early death. So on examination, he had partial insight, but he talked excessively and speech was tangential and circumlocutory. For instance, when I asked him, what is the season? He said, my idea of season is different because I lived in the Northeast. So he also had verbal stereotypy, kept on talking about the same thing again and again. He was oriented. He could not do serial subtraction. He had bilateral ideomotor apraxia, and neuropsychology testing revealed executive dysfunction. His ACE was 75. So basically, he had impaired backward digit span, fluency was poor, and trail speed was also impaired. So here you can see, very briefly, I'll show the video. So you can see the eye movements. Though the gaze is full, his movements are very slow. And here you can see the involuntary movements, the foot tapping, as well as the hand movements. So he's swinging his foot, and you can see the foot movements also there. There. So he had involuntary movements. So to summarize the neurological examination, basically he had ocular movement abnormalities, he had some chorea, he had some extrapyramidal signs, there was postural instability, and he also had probably a left alien hand, but there was no cortical sensory loss, no amyotrophy, no fasciculations. There were some release reflexes, but no grasp. So what is a diagnosis? So we will come back to this again at the end of the talk. I hope that gives you a flavor of the frontotemporal dementias, which can have such a heterogeneous clinical presentation. So one of the earliest studies on prevalence of early onset FTD was done by us in Cambridgeshire, where we found the prevalence was around 15 by 100,000, and it was the same for early onset Alzheimer's disease. So this was before the age of 65 years. And a recent study has suggested the prevalence was around the same, 10 per 100,000. This is again in UK. But the important thing which I want to understand is, though it is considered an important cause of early onset dementia, it is under-recognized in older age, 30% present above 65 years, which you can see even here in this prevalence study. So that's very important. So one should also consider in a patient who is older that it could, a behavioral syndrome could be an underlying FTD. So under the rubric of frontotemporal dementia, you can have a behavior or personality changes which predominate. Then it becomes either a behavioral variant FTD or a right temporal variant FTD. When patients present with language dysfunction or a primary progressive aphasia, it can be a semantic variant or a non-fluent variant. And if they have a motor syndrome, it can be CBD or PSP. And actually, it also misses one, motor neuron disease, that also comes under the motor manifestation. So this whole thing can have a frontotemporal lobar degeneration. Sorry, am I audible?
You're fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah, because I heard some. So on pathology, they can be characterized by different kinds of abnormal proteins which get deposited. So it can be a predominantly tau, which is present mainly in the motor manifestations, or it can be TDP, especially in semantic variant, or it can be a combination, either a TDP, FUS, or tau in the behavioral variant, which is has an inconsistent pathology. So the whole rubric of frontotemporal lobar degeneration has these kind of subtypes. And the other important point I would like to make is, even though they may start with an isolated personality change, for instance, a BVFTD, they may develop a Parkinsonism, or a Parkinsonism patient who presents predominantly with motor disorder can start having behavioral changes. And the same is true of the language variants. So they may not remain pure during the course of their evolution. So I don't want to go into the details of genetics except to mention that there are three important mutations which have been recognized: the tau mutation, the MAPT, the C9orf72, which Dr. Ghoshal has mentioned already, and the progranulin mutations. These are very important, and especially the C9orf72 has a lot of relevance to psychiatrists. So if you take overall the frontotemporal dementias, around 30% have positive family history. So the neuropsychiatric features have already been alluded to by both the chairperson and Dr. Krishnamurthy. So they can have a wide variety of symptoms like apathy, disinhibition, which can be a sexual inappropriateness, hypersexuality. They can make bad jokes. They can be socially inappropriate. They may be having disrobing, impulsivity, which may lead to buying shopping sprees. We had a patient who started buying online and even bought things like washing machines, vacuum cleaners, which were definitely not needed. Or they can have shopping sprees where we had a patient who was buying silk saris. So she bought silk saris and gold. So it can be disastrous for the family. So they can have different kinds of disinhibition. Motor stereotypies are quite common, and sometimes they can give you the clue that you are dealing with an FTD. So it can be simple stereotypies like tapping, or restless behavior, pacing, or it can be a more complex ritualistic behavior where they can have like a hypergraphia, or they can have even doing excessive puja, becoming extremely religious. They have lack of empathy. Food fats and gluttony are very common, with sweet preference. In fact, many patients come with families say that they were very disciplined earlier and now they start eating junk food. So drinking soft drinks, all this may be very common. They may also develop new addiction. Cigarette smoking as well as alcohol addiction has also been noticed. Psychosis is an important feature. People can have hallucinations, delusions, but more common in the C9 or 72 mutations. So this is the clinical diagnostic criteria. So they should have three of these six features, along with typical findings on the neuroimaging, which is usually you should use a coronal T1 to see the atrophy, which may be mesial frontal, orbitofrontal, and anterior insular. So they can also be associated temporal lobe atrophy. It can be symmetrical or it can be asymmetrical. And if the scan is normal, you can do a PET scan, which may show hypometabolism in these areas. So the definitive diagnosis will be either by a genetic mutation or pathological confirmation. So please note that here, apart from reduced empathy, no other mention of social cognition is made. And other important point I want you to note is that here it talks about relative sparing of episodic memory and visuospatial functioning, which you will see later that it may not be actually true of FTD. So on examination, besides the behavior and the cognitive functions, obviously one should look at any neurological signs. So which could be, like I mentioned, any Parkinsonism, look at ocular movements carefully, gait, postural instability. Apart from that, you should look for amyotrophy, release reflexes. And also sometimes patients can have striking imitation or utilization behavior. So this patient has been instructed again and again not to touch any objects in the on the table. So there's a compulsive need to manipulate and also use the object. So this is an example of utilization behavior. So he's actually taken both the rings. He has taken the money, has worn the glasses. You could see that. In fact, he didn't like it on the finger and he's also changing the, it was loose. So he's changing it. So this is an example of utilization behavior. Striking utilization behavior has been actually reported by Ghosh and colleagues from Calcutta, in fact, that they find that patients with BVFTD have a very high proportion of these changes in their cohort. So like I mentioned, though it is considered that the episodic memory is relatively spared, there are many studies which have now shown that actually the memory impairment is quite striking even in BVFTD, though it may not be as severe as AD, the free recall, but it can still be impaired. So that is one thing which we should remember, because most of our patients, in fact, when they come to the clinic, they say that they do have memory complaints. So that's not you should not exclude the diagnosis just because they have memory impairment. So when one looks at the overlap of clinical features, obviously Alzheimer's disease is one of the commonest disorders which we encounter, and we need to see whether we need to exclude that. And there are also variants of Alzheimer's disease where they present predominantly with a frontal variant where they have predominantly behavioral changes. So one of the things which one can do is obviously neuropsychology. If there is a predominant executive dysfunction like impaired trail speed, impaired letter fluency as compared to semantic fluency, that may suggest BVFTD. But remember that if this profile is present, then it is suggestive. But if it is absent, it does not exclude the diagnosis of BVFTD. The other important point I would wish to make is that this distinction between semantic fluency and lexical fluency, semantic fluency when they have to generate words from a category like an animal, and lexical fluency is words beginning with a particular letter or a syllable in Indian languages. And usually patients with Alzheimer's disease have more difficulty with semantic fluency, while patients with FTD have more difficulty with lexical fluency. But in our study, we found that this may not be actually true. So the other important clinical clues may be lack of insight, because this is the first thing which you ask the patient, what is your complaint? So patients may have lack of insight in FTD, but the Alzheimer's patients usually do have preserved insight. They also look very anxious. In fact, every question you ask them, they look at their spouse for an answer. While the FTD patients may have a flat affect or they may be disinhibited. So apart from looking at the total scores on neuropsychology, say, the qualitative pattern is more important. The way the patient approaches the test, the type of errors may sometimes give you more information. So if the patient is disinhibited, getting very restless, gets up repeatedly, has problems in concentration, or is apathetic, doesn't attempt the test, is very perseverative, there are intrusions on the verbal recall test, or there are confabulations, he is very impulsive. Before you finish the instructions, he is attempting the test. All these may suggest more in favor of BVFTD. So sometimes these may be more helpful than just looking at scores or the performance. So social cognition has been now highlighted as one of the most important features of BVFTD, where they can have lack of empathy. There is impaired theory of mind, that is ability to understand others' mental states. There is poor social perception, so they are unable to read facial emotion, body language, and also take social cues. And because of that, they may have abnormal social behavior. They may be inappropriate. They may have a baby tactless. And they may call somebody fat or on their face. They may have lack of manners. So different kinds of tests have been used to differentiate Alzheimer's and BVFTD for emotion recognition, face recognition, four-part test, and things like that. So they do find that there are differences between the two, and the BVFTD are significantly impaired on social cognition tests. So apart from Alzheimer's disease, what would be interest to you would be like primary psychiatric disorders and autism spectrum disorders, which may also overlap with patients with BVFTD. So in this important study, it was found that prior diagnosis of a psychiatric disorder was reported in 50% of BVFTD patients. So these patients received these kind of disorders before they diagnose them with BVFTD. So that's a very important thing. So if we are not aware that there is a syndrome like a BVFTD, sometimes we can make an error. So we need to know what features to look for to make a distinction between primary psychiatric disorder and BVFTD. So like already Dr. Ghoshal has mentioned that I was part of this International Neuropsychiatric Consortium. So we tried to come out with recommendations to distinguish the behavioral variant FTD from psychiatric, primary psychiatric disorders. Obviously, there is not one point which we can say, yes, this is it, and this can differentiate. So unfortunately, we do need to take a complete history, clinical history. There should be evidence of decline. Neuroimaging is definitely very helpful. Neurofilament light chains in some studies have shown that either in serum or CSF may be positive in BVFTD, but may not be so in primary psychiatric disorders. Family history is again helpful, but in C9orf72 gene expansion, there can be overlap. They can have family history of schizophrenia, bipolar disorders, as well as autism spectrum disorders. So sometimes it can get tricky. So you need to do multiple levels of examination, and you need to get evidence from all these levels for us to differentiate the two. So what are the barriers to timely diagnosis of FTD? We looked at this in our cohort of 855 patients, and we found that the time to diagnosis was significantly more in FTD patients, median of 32 months compared to 24 months for Alzheimer's and 18 months for vascular dementia. Obviously, one can say that probably it is still less as compared to what has been reported from other countries like Brazil. They reported almost a 6-year delay. So there are problems, barriers at different levels. So the family and the patient, obviously low awareness is one of the important barrier. Apart from that, there are cultural barriers, beliefs and shame and stigma associating dementia with amnesia, not recognizing that behavioral symptoms can be a harbinger of dementia, for instance. So they may not recognize that. Clinician, unfortunately, in India, there is very heterogeneity in the kind of training. So lack of training, lack of awareness, misinterpretation of symptoms, or lack of sufficient time, suitable tools, all these are barriers at the clinical level. And obviously, there are problems at the health system level. Affordability and accessibility will be one very important factors which prevent timely diagnosis. So this is another important issue in the cross-cultural issues in FTD. So again, Amitabh Ghosh and colleagues from Calcutta have reported that more 90% of patients meet the criteria by 3 years when they come to the clinic with FTD. And similarly, in this cross-cultural study between US, Greece, and Turkey, though the duration of illness was shorter in Greeks and Turkish patients, the scores on, for instance, the CDR scores, as well as the NPI scores and the MMSE scores were less, and the behavioral scales were more. So this is an important point. Even if the duration was short, the disease was more florid. So that's a very important thing to recognize. So even if people mention only 1 or 2 years, but at the time when we assess them at the clinic, they're already quite impaired, suggesting that probably there was a longer duration of illness and some of these symptoms were either missed. So there can be something like an atypical BVFTD, also known as phenocopy syndrome. And here, they present to the clinic in 50s and 60s. They meet the criteria for BVFTD, but do not progress. Scans may be normal. They may have stable cognition and social cognition, typically male, and they do not have much atrophy on the MRI. And some of them previously not recognized, but now they feel that they could be slow progressing carriers of C9 or 72. In these disorders, actually, the atrophy can be less, and they also may not progress very rapidly. So one may not recognize them. The other point to consider is autism spectrum disorder. Actually, this is an evolving field. There's a lot of research which is going on trying to understand autism spectrum disorders and the BVFTD and the phenocopies. So there are definitely points in overlapping features in all three disorders. So one should also be cautious, because we should not over-diagnose patients. This happens all the time. Like I said, executive dysfunction. Sometimes patients are mislabeled as executive dysfunction, or the atrophy is mislabeled on the scans. So that can also happen, but maybe more common with depression. So depression and apathy sometimes may be difficult to differentiate in the best of settings. So if the patient has milder disease, better cognition, sometimes there can be also over-diagnosis of FTD. So one should be careful about this. So I would like to end my talk talking about the semantic dementia and the non-fluent aphasia very briefly. So in semantic dementia, this is a very interesting primary progressive aphasia, because there is transmodal deterioration of semantic knowledge, word meaning, vocabulary, and facts. And it is characterized by asymmetric atrophy, usually left side, both anterior and medial temporal atrophy. So there is usually impaired object naming, impaired recognition, but syntax and repetition is spared. So the other important thing is they can have behavioral features as well. So they can have disinhibition, clock watching, food fads, they may all be present. So this is a patient who had come to us with difficulties with language for last 2 years. And he also is a multilingual. Here in the video, he's speaking Kannada, but he also speaks English and Hindi. So he has lost both English and Hindi. And this is when the patient is unable to name objects, you test word picture matching. So here he has to match the word, spoken word, with the picture, which is a very easy task. Most patients with aphasia, for instance, can do this because they recognize the word even though they are not able to name the object. So he's pointing to the pig for squirrel.
Hasu elide.
So that's a striking feature. So he could not recognize any of the animals and finally called them all dog. So he has a superordinate knowledge that they're all animals and dogs probably, but he doesn't know anything beyond that. So that's an impaired word recognition. It's a classical feature of semantic dementia or semantic variant PPA. So this we published in Journal of Neurology, where we found a dramatic loss of less proficient languages in our 18 patients of semantic dementia, which was seen in both literate, illiterate, as well as with different languages. And we also hypothesized that these patients share a common semantic system for different languages. That means there is an opportunity to even study patients in our setting because we have unique cultural features. And so that's a different avenue for research as well. So the right temporal variant, which I already mentioned in the classification, which we have not seen in our patients, most of them, but generally it has been described that the right variant semantic dementia has striking behavioral changes, lack of empathy, disinhibition, but they can also have prosopagnosia and visual memory impairment. So here the asymmetric temporal lobe atrophy is more striking on the right side as compared to the left side. So they don't present so much with language difficulty, but they present more with behavioral changes as well as difficulty in recognizing people. So the non-fluent aphasia is actually more difficult sometimes to diagnose. They can have achromatism, apraxia, non-fluent speech with intact word comprehension, but they may later develop motor features, as I already mentioned, either corticobasal syndrome or a PSP. Logopenic variant, though associated with Alzheimer's disease most often, has also been mentioned recently that it can be present with progranulin mutations, for instance. Here, this behaves like a conduction aphasia, which you see post-stroke, where there's impaired repetition, but they do have some mild dysnomia, but they can understand spoken speech. Unfortunately, there is no FDA-recognized therapies which are available from frontotemporal dementia. So usually we do symptomatic treatment. There is very limited evidence, and we also need to watch for side effects, but families are desperate because sometimes the behavioral problems are very challenging. So the most common group of drugs which are being used are SSRIs. And other drugs have also been tried, like stimulants for mainly apathy, intranasal oxytocin, antipsychotics, lithium, topiramate for especially eating disorders, and agomelatine. But definitely there is nothing to recommend one over the other. But we typically use SSRIs in our clinic, but we always start slowly and hike slowly. So that's very important. And if we use atypical antipsychotics like quetiapine or something, we use a very small dose, half tablet of 25 mg and go very slowly and use it for the shortest duration possible, because sometimes the behavior disorder changes. They may no longer be agitated or aggressive after a few weeks. So it doesn't mean that they should be continued indefinitely. And you should definitely use micro doses as compared to what psychiatrists use for other patients. The important thing to recognize is that cholinesterase inhibitors as well as memantine can also worsen behavior in BVFTD, and one should not use them for these disorders. But there's one study which showed that they improved aphasia in PPA, but not in BVFTD. If at all you want to consider, you can consider for the language variant, but not in BVFTD. So there's a lot of emerging treatments which are available, but all of them target the specific mutations. So they talk about antisense oligonucleotides, increasing progranulin, tau immunization, but they may be therapies for the future. So we are very much lagging behind because we don't have large genetic studies. Whatever has been done is negative in India so far. So we, in all other countries, when they talk about the research, they always mention about their the genetics, and many of them have the genetics and they do carrier studies and they have the whole families genetics, which we really are quite behind. So non-pharmacological strategies are very, very important for behavior management, and that should be tried as a first approach. So that includes games, music, hobbies, routinizing therapy, using a simple routine, because patients definitely can learn routine, and environmental approaches have also been tried. But there are, again, no systematic randomized trials. Caregiver support intervention are very, very important because there's a high level of stress and burden. So education, social support interventions, again, are very important. And we definitely do not have enough infrastructure to cope with all these. Like Dr. Krishnamurthy does a fantastic job of trying to integrate everything into one, this thing. But there are still very few of these kind of centers which are available. I know the ARDSI local chapters also do a lot of work in different cities trying to run programs, daycare centers, but we do need more. So coming to the survival, there's a recent review in JNNP which suggested that there are factors which are associated with poorer survival and improved survival. So obviously older age at onset, and if there is atrophy, early motor symptoms suggest poorer survival. But if there is higher occupational attainment, mild atrophy or no atrophy on imaging, changes in eating behavior may suggest improved survival. So the life expectancy is usually 3 to 14 years from symptom onset. But if it is motor onset, definitely the duration is much less. As compared to, say, a language variant, sometimes it can progress very slowly and they can survive for longer, including even the semantic variant. So what was the diagnosis in the first clinical vignette? So this is the scan of that patient. He had a striking right temporal atrophy. There was definitely frontal atrophy as well and diffuse atrophy, but you can see that definite atrophy here. And there's also atrophy of the midbrain. And subcortical regions, at least there is definitely dilatation of the caudate and frontal horn and also the body of the ventricle. So we considered different features, like I mentioned here. So if is involuntary movements, chorioathetosis, alien hand will favor corticobasal syndrome, false and gaze palsy will favor PSP, but his behavior and neuropsychology was suggestive of frontal dysfunction with the striking asymmetric temporal lobe atrophy. We thought it's a FTD overlap syndrome or FTD motor disorder. So obviously we didn't do the genetics in this patient, so we are not aware of it. So thank you very much for your invitation, and I would like to thank my patients and families from whom we're learning every day, my teachers and many colleagues who refer to the cognitive neurology clinic, and we run it from Bangalore and Mysore now. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your excellent and very informative talk on FTD, ma'am. So it was a very detailed presentation on FTD. So recently, ma'am, we had a small case like admitted for just 1 week ago. Her presentation is like she is around 55-year-old woman. She presented with just a 1 year history of she was getting intermittently aggressive. She was having some psychotic symptoms intermittently. There were conflicts with the family members, and also she was forgetting. And there were some behavior, ritualistic behaviors, like she used to collect all water bottles and keep it in one room. So, and she used to have a conflict with her daughter-in-law saying that, like, now you have stolen my things and all. So just to cover up, since she was forgetting. So there was increased conflict in the family. So last 15 days and all, she got so agitated that, like, she was almost we had to admit her. So we admitted her. So our first impression was like, since there was, is it just a primary psychiatric illness, or is there any FTD component or any dementia component is there? So we found that, like, in the ward also, like on the day of admission, she was very restless in the ward. She is going into the different rooms. Some sometimes she is coming out of the bathroom suddenly without any this one. So there were such behaviors. So we thought probably there might be some component of maybe FTD. So we did a like MRI. MRI picture is that was like MRI is more or less normal. So there is no significant atrophy in the frontal and temporal lobe. Although we did it with a dementia protocol which we have in radiology, and to do that, like we also did a neuropsychological evaluation, which found that like there is a significant component of impairment, like with respect to frontal lobe dysfunction and all. So there was also even verbal comprehension issues were there. So a psychologist was of opinion that there is a like it's an early onset dementia, probably with memory, with behavioral disturbance. So in such case, like today we discharged that patient. And one interesting thing what I found when I was discharging the patient, the family member said, her daughter said, sir, like, is there any problem with risperidone? How is the risperidone? How safe is risperidone? I just asked, like, what is that? Because my son is having autism. He's being prescribed with risperidone for last 3 years. So I found a bit interesting that such relationship probably between FTD and autism, which you were highlighting. So in such cases where we have a clinical acumen saying that, yes, there is a strong need for a strong suspicion of FTD, but still on MRI-wise, like we do not see significant atrophy. So in such cases, like how to go about that? So how will be our approach?
Are you going to answer, Dr.
Krishna? Yes.
I think the question is to you.
Okay.
Well, yes.
No, one thing is that you should do a coronal MRI, T1.
Coronal.
Because sometimes on the axial, you cannot make out the atrophy. So they pointed that out very distinctly that you should look at the coronal T1 to look at the frontal atrophy. So that's a very important factor. Because the insula and the medial frontal you need to look at. So you should do a coronal T1. Then second thing is obviously a longitudinal assessment, keep her under follow-up. And number three is definitely you can do a PET scan to see if there is any hypometabolism in those areas. So those are very important. And the other thing I want to mention is that, see, even though we don't take into account sometimes the family dynamics and the culture specific factors, which sometimes color all this behavioral history, especially the dynamics of the family and also the culture. So I don't want to say anything. I'm not meaning anything, this thing, but when we find, like, for instance, Bengalis, they're very emotional people. So one needs to consider all those factors also and find out what are the dynamics in the family, yes. I think, and, you know, the cultural things which may be driving behavior. So those are also very important, which we need to consider, I would say. But doing a PET following up would be important. But like I said, even the neuropsychology, sometimes they may not perform properly because, for instance, if she is very agitated, she may be very restless, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah,
so we may not be very sure about the neuropsychology. Yeah. Unless we are very clear that, for instance, she's doing very well on the visuospatial, very well on some of the test memory, but she's not doing well on these tests only. Then you can say it is most suggestive of a frontal FTD. But otherwise, it may be difficult to do that. But those are my suggestions, a longitudinal assessment, go into the family dynamics. And third would be to do a PET scan if you're still considering BVFTD. And also look for soft neurological signs, like what I mentioned, eye movements, extrapyramidal. And if they also have language features, though, like I mentioned, no one can overlap with the other. So even if BVFTD, suppose if they have semantic problems sometimes, that can definitely suggest it's a BVFTD and not a primary psychiatric disorder, for instance.
Okay. So, thank you, ma'am.
Can I ask the subsidiary question?
Yes.
Because you mentioned SSRIs, and of course, I think Dr. Praveen mentioned risperidone, which was the patient was alluding to. Of course, in autism spectrum disorder, risperidone is the one FDA-approved antipsychotic, so it's quite popular. I wondered about your experience with anti-epileptic drugs as thymoleptic agents in these patients, Dr. Valli.
Yeah, so I'm using lamotrigine, especially when they are very disinhibited and also. So valproate I don't like to use because it can cause tremors and Parkinsonism. So I try and avoid that. So I use lamotrigine. Levipil, again, we know now there's a lot of literature on the mood problems or cognitive problems. So I'm using lamotrigine in some patients where there is marked disinhibition. But I can't tell you that it works or anything. I mean, topiramate worked for in a few patients for eating disorders, like especially when families report that they go in the night and raid the fridge and they keep on eating, or they steal money and buy junk food. And, you know, so then we have the patients who have finished 1 kg of cashew nuts over 2 days. I mean, that kind of binge eating they do. So obviously sometimes you have to probably try medication. So.
Dr. Ghoshal, sir, would you like to put any insights on 90 seconds?
No. Actually, I have some query to madam. Actually, madam has told that in the Raskowski criteria, there is no point of social cognition. That is one of the things which is missing. So in the bedside, how we can easily judge social cognition? That is my one question. And the second one is that we as a clinician, we always think that in FTD, the memory symptom does not come first. The memory symptom come afterwards when there is extensive damage. So, but how many cases you have seen that memory onset FTD?
Yeah. So maybe I can answer that first, second part first. Two-thirds at least come and say they have memory problems. Okay. So the thing is that they can have working memory problems also. Sometimes they're not paying attention. They cannot hold that thing. So the working memory, any cognitive complaint, first of all, in our culture is referred to as memory. Not only in our culture, even internationally. So the commonest symptom of anything, whether it is language, sometimes even behavior, they will say it's a memory problem. The patient has memory problem. That is one. Whether it's true memory or not, one has to obviously find out. But they can have working memory problems where they are not able to hold that information sometimes. So that can also manifest as memory problems. So that can be one of the things. But studies have shown now that they definitely have true memory problems. They perform very poorly on testing. So I'm not sure what are the initial patients whom they found that they were doing very well. But on the whole, when patients do testing, it's very difficult to make out just on the neuropsychology. So lots of them perform very poorly on tests. So their recall is impaired. Recognition may not be impaired to that extent. So words, the pre-recall will be impaired. But when they are asked to recognize, sometimes they do recognize better than AD. But it all depends on the behavior because sometimes they also have intrusions. So even the false positives may be very high. So, but true memory impairment can be seen in DVFTD patients. That is one. That social cognition, unfortunately, they only mentioned lack of empathy, which one needs to ask, is the person affectionate like before? Does he show concern, he or show concern when you fall sick? Or somebody, the children are not well. Does he ask? Does she ask? How are you feeling? Or have you eaten? So these are the kind of questions we ask for lack of empathy. But unfortunately, I'm not aware of any bedside test we can do. You can do facial emotion recognition if you want to keep, especially negative emotions like fear, anger, disgust. They say they are more difficult to recognize by these patients. But unfortunately, I'm not aware of any single test which we can do.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Dr. Praveen, there are a couple of questions in chat.
Yes, sir. I'm reading, taking some question. This is question is on like dementia is in COVID-19 pandemic crisis. Kindly address a preventive and curative role and insight in this matter. So dementia in the context of
COVID. I think even Dr. Krishnamurthy will have a view on this. Maybe you can go first.
Yeah, I've had quite a few patients develop you know, post-COVID delirium, which can obviously be mistaken for dementia, especially if it goes on for a prolonged period of time. And I think it's very important, therefore, to differentiate delirium from, you know, dementia in these patients. That's very important. Post-COVID delirium is reversible. And we've taken a very interesting approach. We have we are using a transcranial direct current stimulation protocol for post-COVID delirium, and with very good results. Most of our patients, after about, we're using 20 sessions. I know colleagues who are using between 15 and 20 sessions for delirium. And we find our patients, all our 5 patients with post-COVID delirium recovered with TDCS. So that's been an interesting learning. I'm yet to encounter, I mean, of course, patients with dementia have developed COVID and COVID-related complications and an exacerbation of their cognitive impairment and so on. So dementia with delirium and so on. But I'm yet to encounter anyone who's developed dementia post-COVID, a non-reversible or a progressive syndrome. I've not seen anyone yet, although I believe that they do exist. There are people with very significant cognitive changes that seem to continue for a longer period of time post-COVID. So that's my limited experience of COVID and COVID-related cognition.
Yeah, I think the other thing which we see is that because of their confinement to homes and not much social interaction and lack of exercise and lack of other social gatherings, activities, the dementia seems to have definitely worsened in some. So I was trying to see whether some carers have also stayed at home, whether that was beneficial. But on the whole, it seems to be more deleterious. Like many patients definitely have deteriorated quite markedly. We find that in the 2 years because of this lack of complete sensory deprivation almost. It's very unfortunate, I think.
So there is another question that is called like, what is stimulus-bound behaviors?
Dr. Valli, would you like to go first?
No, you can definitely answer because okay. I think you also had it in your slide also, isn't it?
So these are stereotypic behaviors which seem to follow certain patterns or rituals and are usually provoked by, what shall I say, the ecosystem within which the person is operating at that particular point in time. And I have this very interesting lady with, she's the Krishna Bhakt. And so she has got a whole range of rituals surrounding her prayers to Lord Krishna. And once she starts on them, there is a great overinvestment in those rituals. Of course, we use them. She's very interestingly, she has gait apraxia. And the way we got around her gait apraxia was that we used the Krishna footsteps in her house, all the pathways that she needed to walk. So, you know, she would go from her bedroom to the living room. She would go from the living room to the front veranda. Then she'll go back to her bedroom. She had one routine. And what we found was when we gave her the visual cue of the Krishna footstep, she could actually walk on those footsteps very easily. So she got over her gait apraxia that way. That's something we discovered in rehabilitation, working with her. The other thing was that she had a huge language impairment and she had great difficulty producing words. But interestingly, she could sing. The moment you put on a Krishna bhajan, she'll start singing with it. And her singing ability, especially for the bhajans, was very well preserved. And we use these two. So in a way, there was an overinvestment in ritualistic and stereotypic behaviors. But we also used them as part of a rehabilitation process because it helped us stay engaged you know, with activity and it helped the family engage her in some activity because otherwise she was just you know, sitting around doing very little. So we are talking about stereotypic and repetitive behaviors in which there is a great overinvestment. Interestingly, the parallel to behaviors in autism, again, you see in young people with autism spectrum disorder, they have stereotypic and repetitive behaviors in which they greatly overinvest. And one of the first things I read about autism, it stays in my head. It's a short piece by a doctor in JAMA. This was in the 1990s. It was called The Phantom of the Opera. And she talked about her child with autism who would play the same musical piece every day, repeatedly several times, and then, make the same movements to that musical piece. So in a sense, stereotypic and repetitive behaviors. I guess it's more to do with which part of the brain is involved. Vali, I'll let you.
No, I think you've explained it quite well. I think that's more than
very interesting, sir. Very interesting explanation. We have with us Dr. Atri Chatterjee, who is also a cognitive neurologist. Dr. Atri Chatterjee, would you like to comment or give some insight?
Thank you. It's nice meeting you. I have heard Dr. Vali for a long time. I recently heard her lecture in the AIC FTDP hour. Nice to listen to your talks again, Dr. Krishnamurthy. Fantastic talk. Thank you. My primary work while I was working in Vancouver, and my primary focus of work was on the genetic FTD. And we were following up families with genetic mutations. And my primary focus was the initial changes before the diagnosis of FTD. And we just completed our manuscript. So it seems that although we are calling all these syndromes as FTD, the biology is quite different depending on the different mutations. And it's possible that possibly 10 years from now, we'll have a family of diseases where the overarching name is still FTD, but there are subclassifications. And this is already emerging in terms of having the language subtypes and the behavioral and the motor subtypes. Depending on the different mutations, the first symptoms, the evolution of the neuropsychiatric symptoms and the language and the cognitive symptoms, language and otherwise, is quite different. So there was this question about what about memory in FTD? So my presentation in last year's AAIC was on this same topic, where I was looking at the specifically patients who were later found out to have TDP43 pathology. And it seems that patients with FTD TDP43 have a high prevalence of memory symptoms in the first presentation in their clinic. So on the other hand, patients who have an FTD, say FUS, are less likely to have memory symptoms at the first presentations. So there are underlying biological subgroups under the rubric of FTD. The other question that I would like to address is the social cognition issue. This is a very important issue. And even cognitive neurology fellows are not always well trained in testing for social cognition. It's kind of now being a more important focus in training as well as recognition in the clinic. We used to use the Ekman's 60 faces test that was there in the clinic in UBC. I don't have the proprietary test with me in Calcutta. So I have basically printed out just photographs of people with those emotions from the internet, and primarily with stronger emotions, as Dr. Vali said, with disgust and anger. And just I'm trying to test this out, how this works out in our culture. And so far, I think we need to kind of devise how to frame the question to test social cognition, because I guess fresh from the fellowship, I'm still in my frame of mind from Vancouver, but a direct translation may not work. A direct translation of English questions may not work. So we need to frame the question in different Indian languages, not only after showing them the reaction. And also the photographs I printed out are obviously Western photographs. So I guess we need to see whether we can measure social cognition in a better way with Indian pictures. I think there will be a difference.
Thank you, Dr. Atri.
If I can say something, Dr.
Yes, Pravin. Yes, sir. Please.
I think given that we are the land of IT, Doc, you'll find someone who will create an app for you very quickly. And that's probably going to be your quick solution rather than have to go through a complex test. Just wanted to add, you're talking about recognition of facial expression. Just takes us back to this very interesting neuropsychiatric underpinning that one of the first conditions in which it was recognized that recognition of facial expression was poor was in people with psychopathy. So psychopathic individuals fail to recognize emotions and emotional expression. So it takes us back once again, I think, to the region we are talking about. We all look at it in silos, depending on where, which specialty we are in. But ultimately, probably it's the frontal, prefrontal cortex and its various connections that play a role.
Actually, I am working on a project on acquired psychopathy in frontotemporal dementia. There is a bit of literature, not a lot, but in fact, Dr. Mario Mendez from UCSF have worked on this. He actually worked on the people in the death row in the LA County, and he tried to understand how many of them had an observable objective brain lesion in the neuroimaging, and he had quite striking results. So I think that would be a very interesting overlap between psychopathy and the FTD phenotype.
But actually, they do find very nice to meet you, Dr. Chatterjee.
Thank you.
Welcome. They need more cognitive neurologists in India and neuropsychiatrists. It's very nice. So I was saying that they did test them in all these primary psychiatric disorders as well as autism spectrum disorders, and they find a variety of social cognition impairments. So they have not yet found a specific test only for BVFTD, because as a group, they definitely perform maybe worse than the primary psychiatric disorder and autism spectrum. But in an individual patient, you may still be stuck. And also, I find that when coming to culture, when you show faces and ask them to name the emotion, I think our patients are always find that more difficult. Maybe if you give the emotion and say, point to the face, that may be much easier task for them to do. Because I find that that's kind of the kind of culture we have. It's very difficult for them to, specify the name, especially things like disgust and all. It's much more easy to say happy and sad faces, but things like
this. Basically, the question I'm trying to test out is I'm asking them, how do you think this person is feeling? So I think that's a more closer to theory of mind question. So I'm not asking for a space, they can describe it. So I'm not asking for a definite word. So I'm asking them, how do you think this person is feeling? But it's. I guess most patients are still not used to this kind of testing.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying.
They're quite surprised.
Because having tested so many people over 30, 40 years, I know how difficult they find to answer these kind of questions. I think it's a cultural thing. It's not, we are not used to that.
Madam, there is a video actually trained. There is a test which has been devised from developed in the NIMHANS.
Yeah.
By Venkat Subramanian group actually. Is that useful?
I don't know, because even I think Dr. Suvarna's group also has developed something for emotion, this thing. But like I said, I'm very skeptical about how it's going to work in our population. I find it's easier to do things which you are more confident about rather than just doing it because we need to test this. So I'm not really sure. Even I asked them, how do you even call disgust in your language? I mean, it's like, what is the label you're giving these emotions also? It's not that we don't have emotions, because we have that Navarasa and all our literature and dance and everything. But still, when it comes to the colloquial terms, people sometimes do not have the words to express. Because like when I say sentence, when you ask the people to write sentence, they struggle with it unless they are at least 12 years plus of education, because we have words per sentence in all our languages. So I think that sometimes the cultural barriers are there and for us to overcome when we design tests and we test patients. I mean, that's my view. I'm not trying to be gloomy, but I think it just needs to be tweaked in a different way. That's all.
Another query, ma'am. When Hodges came in Calcutta, someone asked him that what is his take on the frontal variant of AD. And he outright actually told that there is no frontal variant of AD. It is all BBFTD actually that is being given the name of frontal variant of AD. What is your take on that?
Well, there is definitely a frontal variant of AD, which has been very well described with the pathology. So I'm sure that there is definitely a frontal variant. My take is that. But like he said, that all syndromes may be soon defined more by, you know, biomarkers and by genetics. And we are so much lagging behind. It's like very distressing, actually, when you go to any international forum, because we don't have the information on our cohorts.
And regarding this atypical, this phenocopy syndrome, is also a controversial entity. Somebody tells that there is some slowly progressive BBFTD, which is phenocopy syndrome. Someone tells that there is no such actually phenocopy syndrome.
No. I think that definitely it is there, because these are people who have been studied for many years in some countries like John Hodges group and other groups. Definitely they have. But with the genetics now, they think that some of them are definitely C9 or mutation carriers, because they have found, like he mentioned, pre-symptomatic, there is now a lot of studies where they're trying to look at the carriers and trying to find out when their biomarkers become positive, when they start having cognitive changes. So they're doing longitudinal studies of the mutation carriers. So there are a lot of publications now recently which are appearing, and they seem to suggest that the C9ORF in particular has a slow rate of progression. So the atrophy may not be evident in the scans early. So that may be one of the reasons they may be phenocopies. But obviously, we don't know the whole story. And like with the primary psychiatric disorders, autism spectrum disorder also, there is a lot of studies now, because they find that the BPFTD have one-third of the, if they have family history, they may have a primary psychiatric disorders. So, and autism spectrum disorders. So that definitely. So there's a lot of linkage to many things. Mm-hmm. So I think it's an evolving field, and probably things will be clear.
Actually, we have also seen many cases, we have seen some cases, at least 3 or 4 cases of bipolar disorder, which were bipolar for a long time, but ultimately they developed BBFTD. And then I searched the literature and found that there is some either C9ORF72 or progranulin mutation, and that actually is linked to this bipolar and this BBFTD.
Very true. So there is your biological basis, biological psychiatry. So should add the FTD to the...
Yeah. We had one interesting case of FTD where, like, sister was having FTD and her brother, like, I had seen him 2 years back. He presented with bipolar disorder with catatonia features. And just 1 month back, again, he called, like, now his cognitive issues have started. So that's how, like, people say, like, although there is a significant, as you said, one-third of the variant FTD have a family history of psychiatric illness. So sometimes people say that probably psychiatric illness are less phenotypic variant of FTD kind. Even they say schizophrenia has a less phenotypic less penetrance, like with respect to genetics. So what is your take on them?
No, and I'm aware of many people who are investigating this from Amsterdam, Yolande Pingenberg and Emma Devenevy from UK. They're all investigating that. They've already reported about this high proportion of psychiatric disorders in patients with BVFTD. Some of them are definitely C9 ORF mutations, but not all of them. So maybe there are still hitherto unrecognized mutations which will probably discovered. So like I said, it's an evolving area. I think we'll have more clarity after some time. So unless Dr. Atri can say something.
So 2 points on circling back to the question on frontal AD, because one of my responsibilities in UBC was to maintain the autopsy database. And what has happened with the frontal variant of AD is before 2006, most of the pathologies of the molecular staining for most of the pathologies of FTD, including TDP43 and FUS, were not available. So the only immunohistochemistry that was available was basically amyloid and tau. So we could only recognize FTD tau, and everything else was Alzheimer's disease. And a lot of patients who presented with symptoms like FTD were diagnosed as frontal variant of AD because there were some degree of, say, BRCA2/3 pathology of Alzheimer's disease. Now, after 2006, this changed because the immunohistochemistry of TDP43 and FUS developed, and now this is now quite widely available. And it seems that the proportion of frontal variant of AD has radically shrunk now. And now the CSF biomarkers being available clinically in a lot of clinics, when we are in doubt for whether this is frontal variant of AD versus FTD, because as Dr. Valli said, there will be a difference in response to cholinesterase inhibitors. So it's an important decision. So when we are doing the CSF biomarkers antemortem, it seems that there is a frontal variant of AD, but its proportion is much less than what was thought before. And so that is one of my observations regarding frontal variant of AD. The second question is related to, sorry, kind of losing my cue here. The second question was related to?
Family history.
Yes, so it's the same group, Dr. Devaney's group, which showed that they did a very, very large study. It was on nearly 1,400 people who are all relatives of FTD patients, and the odds ratio of developing a psychiatric disorder is very high. It's at least, some of the disorders have a 300% or more risk of increase. My interpretation of the data that was published in Neurology is that there is possibly a fertile soil of development of the psychiatric disorders. So even in the family members who do not have an FTD-causing mutation such as CNORF, they have this fertile soil on the top of which epigenetic changes are happening. So these people are developing increasing rates of psychiatric disorders as they age. And the epigenetics of FTD is again, so we are now into, in the past 15 years, we have discovered a lot of genes that are causing FTD. Now we are into epigenetics of FTD, where there is not a single point mutation, but there are a lot of DNA changes that are predisposing the people to psychopathology as well as development of FTD. So my biological interpretation is that the family members have a fertile soil for development of psychiatric disorders.
So, thank you, sir. I think we are approaching towards the end of the webinar. So, it was a very interesting crosstalk between two cognitive neurologists and two expert neuropsychiatrists. So, it was very interesting webinar. So, I would like to thank Dr. Krishnamurthy, sir, for giving this opportunity to conduct such webinar. And so, I would also like to thank Dr. Ratnavali, ma'am, for giving us such a beautiful insight on FTD. And I would like to thank Dr. Ghoshal, sir, for giving his insights and very pertinent questions on FTD. And I would like to thank my friend, Dr. Atri Chatterjee, for giving a very recent insightful explanations on FTD by his recent experience. So it was a wonderful webinar. So thank you very much. I would like to thank all participants who witnessed such an interesting crosstalk. So we are planning to conduct such more neurology and neuropsychiatry crosstalks in future on various different neuropsychiatric topics. So I would like to also thank Sun Company, Abir, for giving us this platform. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Ghoshal, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. I have learned many things from this seminar. Thank you, madam. Thank you, Dr. Krishnamurthy, for your excellent speech and Dr. Othry Chatterjee. I have met you for the first time, but I am meeting you for the first time. But you have given excellent inputs in the recent developments of the frontotemporal dementia. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Ghoshali. Asked very difficult questions.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Recording stopped.